oma kaukau.
The children of Hawaii still remember with love the last Hawaiian monarch, Queen Liliuokalani, who died nearly 74 years ago. She remains a unifying force in the collective spirit of the Hawaiian people. The Hawaiians.
The Hawaiians are the native people of Hawaii. They are the children of Papa and Wakea. They are the indigenous sources. They are the roots of the taro.
The Hawaiians are those that dance to the beat of one drum, and that is the drum of the dance, which is hula.
Hawaii makes up the northern point of the Polynesian Triangle, with New Zealand in the southwest and Easter Island in the southeast. Archaeologists believe that the islands were the last to have been settled by Polynesians between 500 and 700 AD. The early Hawaiians were acutely aware of the geological forces which created their archipelago. And their creation story has Pele, the goddess of volcanoes and fire, making her home deep in Kilauea, the most active volcano on Earth. The Kamaʻāina, or children of the land, in these early times displayed typical Polynesian brilliance in the way they organized themselves.
Hawaiians planted taro. They were farmers, they were fishermen. They built some of the greatest fish ponds that any human eye has ever seen. They farmed breadfruit forests in the uplands. They created, like other Polynesians, great voyaging canoes. So they were a voyaging people, they were fisher folk, they were agriculturalists. You're looking at a society that, for all intents and purposes, is pre-industrial, pre-technological. And in order for that many people to be fed, they had to have tremendous social organization and political control. The Ahupua'a, or land divisions, ran from the mountains to the sea. Within that division, there were smaller, what we would call environmental areas or ecological niches, so that in the uplands, the people who produced products there exchanged them with people from the kailands, which is the ocean, and that enabled that single Ahupua'a to survive. Then they farmed the sea. That's what a fish pond is. And by farming the sea, they enabled themselves to have sort of a ready-made refrigerator where they could go at all times of the year for fish. And all of this, of course, was regulated by the family units, or ohana, in the Ahupua'a, and then further up the political hierarchy by the lesser chiefs called the Kaukaualii, and then the premier chiefs called the Ali'i Nui.
The Ali'i Nui controlled separate chiefdoms. Almost 200 years ago, Kamehameha the Great began a campaign of unification through conquest, making the Hawaiian Islands an independent Polynesian kingdom, which was to last until 1893, when the Hawaiian nation was overthrown.
I'm honored to stand beside a great lady. She's Queen Liliuokalani, the last of the Hawaiian monarchs. In 1893, she was forcibly overthrown, marking the end of Hawaiian sovereignty.
The overthrow was instigated by a group of haole businessmen, fearful of the power of this lady. Later, she suffered the indignity of house arrest in the palace. Annexation by the United States quickly followed. The story of how the Hawaiians were forced into this position is a familiar one in the Pacific, European commerce. In the early 1790s, American sea captains discovered a lucrative trade for them in sandalwood. The vast sandalwood forests on this land were quickly exhausted. Whalers were frequent visitors at the same time as the sugarcane fields were established. Thus began the Western moneyed economy, It marked the advent of capitalism and wage labor in Hawaii, with workers brought from China, Japan, and other countries. Commercial agricultural development followed with pineapple plantations.
When the sandalwood forests were depleted, sugar and pineapple were the main source of income. Today, of course, tourism is the main industry. And next to that is the military.
Today, the military spends about $2 billion annually, making it the second largest industry in the islands. The military number between 180 to 200,000 and control significant land areas in the archipelago. The native Hawaiians have to live with the fact that Aina Hawaii now has more nuclear weapons per land mass than anywhere in the United States. Pearl Harbor has a long history of military occupation. Most Pacific Islands believe that tourism will be their economic salvation, but there's a price to be paid. Is this progress? Tourist spending accounts for about 30% of the Hawaiian economy. The huge multinational interest in the Hawaiian Islands means that the benefits of this slip out of the hands of the native Hawaiians. The scale of tourist development is such that the delicate environmental balance has been upset and can only get worse. Some call it the prostitution of Hawaii.
Prostitution, if we look at it as a metaphor, applies to Hawaii in this way. The prostitute is Hawaii. She's like a woman. She's beautiful. She's fragile. But you can't have her unless you pay. Okay? So you pay as a tourist, you pay as a developer, you pay as a multinational corporation. The more you pay, the more you get. The longer you can stay with her. That's essentially the metaphor. Now, there's the pimp. That's the person who deals with the John, the one who comes, and the prostitute who's in the house. Now, who's the pimp in Hawaii? The state of Hawaii. The state of Hawaii is the pimp. It allows permits. It allows height and density restrictions to be removed. It allows water to be used. And the higher the bidder, the more you get. So the counties of the state of Hawaii, of the archipelago, bid against each other for Japanese development. So if Cebu Corporation comes to Maui County and says, we want to put up a 4,000-room hotel or a 2,000-room hotel, what will you give us? The county of Maui says, oh, we'll suspend all height and density limits. We'll give you the road in front of the hotel, which is a public road. You can make it private. We'll give you the beach so that no locals can go on the beach, so your tourists don't have to see dark-skinned people on the beach. And we'll throw in a few extra added things when you come up for fire inspection. And that's the way Hawaii works. It's criminal. It's like a corrupt third world country. And it's saleable. It's sold all the time, all over the world. The governor and the mayor of the city of Honolulu travel all over the world saying, come to Hawaii, come to Hawaii. This is what we will give you if you build huge hotels, if you invest, if you speculate on land. There's no attempt really to stop that kind of speculation and to stop that kind of development and take care of the native people, none whatsoever.
The tourists may bring in the money, but their sheer numbers overwhelm native Hawaiians.
7 million tourists compares to about 1.25 million residents in Hawaii, of which a quarter, about 180,000 to 200,000, are American military. So of the people who actually live here and aren't transient, like the military are, there are only 1 million. And of that, Hawaiians are about 20% of the population. So relative to the native people here, there are 30 tourists for every native person. And of that, the large number is between 6 and 7 million.
And the effect of this is most felt in the acquisition of land for golf courses. Native Hawaiians are now fighting back.
Well, right now, Hawaiians control less than 2% of all the land in Hawaii, and that's not counting the estates, but individual fee holders. The Japanese, for example, control over 1/5 of Waikiki. Some estimates put it as high as half, as 50%. They are buying up the and creating golf courses on this island. This island is about 95 miles around at its circumference and about 45-50 miles across at its largest point. There are 60 golf courses scheduled or built on this island, most of them private. The Japanese buy golf courses, sell the memberships in Japan, flood the area with their own people. They only hire Japanese-speaking help, so it's not, there are no jobs that accrue from this. Golf courses are enormously polluting. They're environmentally very destructive. They have the highest concentration of insecticides and pesticides. That flows out into our water areas. The bay flows down into the water table. So it's overall, it's a very destructive development. And I might say that the island people in the South Pacific should be very observant of Hawaii, because that's what's blueprinted for them. That's what's happening to Saipan and Rota and Tahiti. That Fiji, that whole idea that the Japanese can come, buy, build, rape, bring all their tourists, and then when the water runs out, or when the fish start dying, or when the pollution is overwhelming, or the smell is terrible, they all evacuate.
Modern Hawaiians are citizens of the United States. What does this mean to them?
The price for being American, an American, is economic security, loss of culture, watering down of our own values in terms of what is a Hawaiian. Being aligned to one of the richest nations in the world, that's part of being an American. Also part of being an American is meaning to be spiritually dead as a Hawaiian.
In 1900, Hawaii was annexed. We became citizens whether we wanted to or not. No one asked us. There was no referendum, no discussion, nothing. So I am a citizen. I do have a passport. But as far as human rights are concerned, I was never asked whether I wanted to be a citizen or whether the United States had any right to make me a citizen or to be here.
So what are you?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, I'm a patriot of the Hawaiian nation. The Hawaiian nation burns in our hearts. It's still alive. It's right here on my land.
Young Hawaiians are now benefiting from the efforts of their kupuna in reviving the Hawaiian culture. Waiau Elementary School, for example, has the only punanaleo or total immersion school. The school has been an enormous success and is seen as not only the savior of Olelo Hawaii, but also the propagator of Lahui Hawaii, the Hawaiian nation. Self-determination is a dream of the school's coordinator, Kalani Akana.
I think it's more like the idea of nations within a nation, like many of the American Indians. In fact, there are about 380-something nations, Indian nation, Native American nations, within the United States. And I think that's the vision of Hawaii. That doesn't mean taking the land from our neighbors. There are lands that are designated as being Hawaiian lands, and there are lands that have been set aside by the federal government for Hawaiians, but are not used for that purpose.
The focus of Hawaiians essentially is to rebase their culture on the land. And whether that entails, you know, land occupations or legal cases. Then beyond that, there's a larger movement to reestablish a Hawaiian government.
If we had sovereignty in that land base and we could become our own guardians instead of having to go to a government and ask for funds, I think that would be the solution.
Our brothers and sisters in Hawaii'i is one of courage and grim determination as they struggle for their identity on many levels. One thing is for sure, with people like Haunani acting on a political level, Kahai Topolinski encouraging cultural growth, and Kalani Akana ensuring the survival of the language, Hawaiian nation will return.
Oh,